Professor Schnur, I want to talk about homelessness to start this conversation, because the governor's care court proposal making its way through the legislature was in some committees this week in the Senate, but it's sure to face some hurdles on the assembly side. But you know, you look at polling data and voting trends and how voters' minds are moving right now, and this is something that is top of mind, and they want leaders to do something about it.
Oh, that's exactly right, Nikki. Even in a deep blue state like California, voters are not just frustrated by the homeless crisis, they're exhausted by it. And Newsom understands that also. Newsom also understands that the more traditional remedies that local and state officials have been trying to confront this crisis haven't been working. And so I think he believes he needs to do something much bigger and bolder and much more dramatic. That's what this care court's proposal is. It's odd to remember now, given the criticism that Newsom got during the pandemic for being too overbearing as governor. But if you think back to his first year or so before COVID, Newsom was criticized for just the opposite, for not taking the lead on legislation. And this looks like maybe for the first time in his governorship on a non-COVID matter, Newsom is going to take the reins. And if this care court's proposal has a chance, he's going to have to fight for it pretty forcefully in the legislature.
Well, I want to stick with that, too, because we're already seeing those who oppose this lineup we saw in the hearings already this week. So this is going to be a battle, right?
This is going to be a battle. And the progressive base of the Democratic Party has real concerns about this. Newsom understands that he will almost certainly be reelected this November. He doesn't want to go out of his way to antagonize his own party's base for all sorts of reasons. But he does realize, and the people around him do realize, that if the voters are going to see him in taking on this homelessness crisis in a meaningful way, he's going to have to push hard. And that's going to mean taking on some of the most liberal voices in his own party. It's not going to be easy, but politically, it's all but necessary for him.
All right, I want to talk about the gas tax now. And the suspension we know is not going to happen. There have been numerous proposals now from Democrats in the Assembly. This latest one we have out this week is out of the Senate. It is this $200 rebate. It seems like the party cannot agree on how they want to get money out to Californians. Do you think that this frustrates voters? Because every single day that goes by, that's another day that they're dealing with inflation and these high gas prices.
It's tremendously frustrating. And not only are California voters not seeing their own elected leaders dealing with a very high price of gasoline here, but if they look around the country, they're seeing exactly the opposite. In Washington, D.C., you see national Democrats moving forward much more aggressively to rein in the cost of gasoline. And even Democratic governors and legislatures in other blue states are moving to suspend or reduce their own gasoline tax. California, by comparison, our elected officials are moving a lot more slowly, and it seems without nearly as much urgency.
Well, and two, we have this giant surplus that Democrats have been touting, and it makes voters think, hey, if we have all this money, why can't they send it back to me? Obviously, things have to work their way through, and there's a procedure in this legislature, but it's taking, it appears, quite some time.
Well, the challenge here, primarily for Democrats, but honestly for a politician of either party who has also spoken out in favor of more aggressive actions against climate change, this puts them in a somewhat awkward position, because a lot of environmental voices are saying, you know what, high gasoline prices are just fine. It will mean people that drive less, and that'll be good for the environment in the climate change discussion in the long term. But what Newsom gets, and a lot of smart politicians of both parties understand, is that the immediate threat of high gas prices in the minds of most voters outweighs what they see as a longer-term threat of climate change. So what you're seeing here in California is the legislature moving toward a rebate for all Californians, not just for motorists, with the idea that maybe it helps alleviate some of the burdens of inflation, but doesn't also specifically encourage additional driving.
All right, I want to ask you about 2022. Of course, we are in an election year. We have voter guides being delivered in the mail. I know I have mine. We have ballots going out in a couple of weeks for the June primary. We know that Governor Newsom hasn't really faced any sort of formidable challengers in Senator Brian Dahle, who is a Republican, and Michael Schellenberger running as a no-party preference candidate. So what races do you think are going to be key to watch here in California?
Well, it doesn't look like the governor's race is going to be particularly competitive, at least not at this point. Kevin Faulkner, the former mayor of San Diego, who ran as a Republican in the recall election last year, has, I think, framed this in the right way. He calls it a recall hangover that his party is suffering from. And a lot of activists and a lot of donors seem to be deciding either to sit out the governor's race or to focus on down ballot campaigns that they find to be more interesting or more competitive. Which means that in all likelihood, the two most competitive and therefore the two most interesting statewide campaigns we'll see this year, at least for candidate races, are for the office of attorney general, where Sacramento District Attorney Anne Marie Schubert is running not as a Republican, but as a no party preference independent candidate against the incumbent, Democrat Rob Bonta, who was not elected to that office 4 years ago, but of course was appointed by Governor Gavin Newsom. The other race that looks very interesting, which often gets very little attention, is the campaign for state controller, where a Hoover Institute fellow at Stanford University by the name of Lan He Chen appears to have a chance to be the first Republican to win statewide office of any type in California since Arnold Schwarzenegger all the way back in 2006. Because California is such a deep blue state, the Democrats are certainly ought to be considered the favorites in both of those campaigns. But Schubert and Chung, for different reasons, could at least make these races competitive and potentially pull off somewhat of an upset.
Finally, though, I want to get your perspective, your view on what's going to happen in Congress this election cycle. Do you think the Republicans are going to take back the House?
Well, the smart money is that Republicans will reclaim the House. And history has shown that with almost no exceptions, only two exceptions in the last 100 years, the party that does not control the White House generally does make significant gains in congressional races. Is it a definite? Look, nothing's definite in 21st century politics. At this point, you'd have to consider Republicans the strong favorites to take back the House. The one thing that could help the Democrats is if the U.S. Supreme Court decided to throw out Roe versus Wade this summer. And that, an action as dramatic as that, might mobilize a sufficient number of pro-choice voters to help the Democrats keep the majority. But even that, I would say, is very much of a long shot.
All right, we will leave it there. Professor Dan Schnur, we thank you for your time here on Inside California Politics.
Thank you for having me.